Hey everyone, today we're diving into something simple but super useful to know if you do anything with web apps, Base64 encoding. This video is part of a new series I'm doing, short, focused videos that explain technical and cybersecurity concepts, especially the ones that come up all the time when working with web applications. If there's a specific concept you want to see covered in this series, let me know in the comments. You've probably seen Base64 before, especially if you've competed in CTFs, but what exactly is Base64 and why is it used so often? Let's break it down. Base64 is a way of representing binary data, like many file formats, as plain printable text. Instead of raw bytes, it turns your data into a string of specific ASCII characters, letters, numbers, plus symbols and forward slashes. Why? Because a lot of systems, especially on the web, are built to work best with text, not binary. Base64 helps ensure that data can be safely transmitted through channels that might otherwise corrupt or misinterpret it. Think of it like translating data into a format that's less likely to break things. You might be wondering, why 64? Well, Base64 uses 64 different characters to represent data. That's important because 64 is a power of 2, specifically 2 to the 6, which means each Base64 character represents exactly 6 bits of data. This makes it easy to convert between binary data, which is made up of 8-bit bytes, and the encoded text. 3 bytes, 24 bits, can be split neatly into 4 6-bit chunks. So what are the benefits? Well, it's generally safe to send in HTTP headers, URLs, and form fields because it avoids special characters that might have meaning in those contexts. It also ensures data doesn't get mangled in transit when moving through systems that expect clean, readable text. It does come with a trade-off though. Base64 increases the size of the data by around 33%, so it's not efficient for huge files, but it is great for small snippets. Let's look at some real-world examples of Base64 in HTTP. When you use HTTP basic auth in an HTTP request, your username and password are joined with a colon. Then that entire string is Base64 encoded and sent in an authorization header. Anyone with access to the request can decode it, so it's not secure on its own, but it's a perfect example of Base64 being used to move credentials as text. JWTs, JSON Web Tokens, are another good example. A JWT has 3 parts, the header, the payload or body, and the signature. Each part is Base64 URL encoded, which is a variant of Base64 designed for URLs, and the encoded parts are then separated by a period. Another place you might see Base64 is in HTML, specifically when embedding image files directly into a web page without linking to a separate file. Instead of referencing an image by its URL, you can include the image's Base64 encoded binary data right in the source attribute. It's especially useful for small icons or single-file HTML documents. Now let's look at how a simple string gets encoded into Base64 and why the output looks the way it does. So these are some slides I'm going to repurpose from another project because I feel like they explain Base64 pretty well. Base64 encodes data into characters from a set of 64. That set includes the uppercase English letters, the lowercase English letters, the digits 0 to 9, the plus symbol, and the forward slash. Base64 encoding works by reading the input 6 bits at a time, converting that to a number from 0 to 63, then encoding that number as a character using a lookup table. For example, the number 0 encodes to an uppercase A, 26 to a lowercase A, 52 to a 0, etc. Since bytes consist of 8 bits, but each Base64 character only needs 6 bits, padding is sometimes required to make up any missing bits. If the number of bytes in the original input is a multiple of 3, no padding is necessary because the number of bits would be a multiple of 24 and therefore a multiple of 6. So we can consider the input 3 bytes at a time until we either have 1 or 2 bytes left. And let's see what happens in those circumstances. So if we have 1 byte or 8 bits of input left to encode, we're going to require 2 base64 characters, since the first base64 character is only going to use the first 6 bits, leaving 2 remaining. In this example, if our remaining input is an ASCII lowercase a, that's represented by these 8 bits. But if we only read the first 6, these 6 bits equal the number 24. That then gets encoded into an uppercase Y. But we have these 2 remaining bits that we need to deal with. And so Base64 is going to pad 4 missing bits with zeros to produce a valid Base64 character. We had these 2 remaining. By padding with 4 zeros, we now get 6 bits. And if we read these 6 bits, this is the number 16, which encodes to an uppercase Q. Now, because we appended 4 bits as padding, that's represented by 2 equal signs. So this equal sign represents these first 2 bits. This equal sign represents these last 2 bits. If we do have a remaining input of a single A, that's going to encode in Base64 to uppercase Y, uppercase Q equals equals. Now let's talk about the case where we've done some encoding and we only have 2 bytes or 16 bits of input left to encode. That's going to require 3 Base64 characters, since the first 2 Base64 characters are only going to use the first 12 bits, which leaves 4 remaining. So again, our remaining input is the ASCII characters AA, lowercase. That's represented by these 8 bits here and these 8 bits here. So if we read 6 bits at a time, these 6 bits equal 24, which again gets represented by an uppercase Y. These 6 bits equals 22, which is encoded to an uppercase W. And then we have these 4 remaining bits. Now, because we have 4 remaining bits, we only need to pad with 2 bits to make that equal to 6. So we do that, we pad them with zeros. And now these 6 remaining bits equals the number 4, which gets encoded to an uppercase E. And because we only padded 2 bits, that just means we have 1 equal sign of padding. And so if we ever get to a situation where our remaining input is just AA, that's going to encode to uppercase Y, uppercase W, uppercase E, and then an equals sign. Okay, let's quickly talk about Base64 decoding. Technically, the equal signs aren't actually needed because the encoder could simply just decode each character until it runs out of bits to use. To decode a Base64 encoded string, we can just reverse the process. Our Base64 encoded string here is uppercase S, uppercase G, lowercase k, and an equals sign. So we're going to go back to that lookup table and we're just going to reverse the lookup process. So an S becomes the number 18, a G becomes the number 6, K becomes the number 36. We then take each of these numbers and we convert them to 6 bits. 18 is these 6 bits, 6 is these 6 bits, 36 is these 6 bits. And now we have 18 bits, but we're going to read 8 bits at a time until we run out. So we read the first 8 bits here, and then we can convert that into an H, right? That's basically just the Unicode or the ASCII code for an uppercase H. We then read the next 8 bits, and this encodes to a lowercase I. We then could look at this equal sign and say, okay, well, the equal sign means there's 2 bits of padding and there are 2 left over, so we can just ignore these. But if you look at it, you can just ignore them anyway, because there's no way these 2 remaining bits are going to encode to anything. But effectively, the Base64 encoded string uppercase S, uppercase G, lowercase k equals decodes to uppercase H, lowercase I, or high. Base64 URL encoding, which I mentioned at the start, is an encoding scheme that's a variation of Base64, considered to be safe for use in URLs. Regular Base64 is technically not URL safe, since it can use a plus, forward slash, and equal sign, all of which are special URL characters. Now, you could encode this using URL encoding, which would sort the problem out, but you can't put Base64 encoded data into a path, for example. The plus, in this case, represents a space in URL encoding, the forward slash is used as a path separator, and the equal sign is used to separate URL parameter keys from values. So there can be sometimes an issue putting Base64 encoded data into a URL. And that's why we have Base64 URL encoding instead. And this resolves the problem because it uses a hyphen instead of a plus and an underscore instead of a forward slash. And since the equal sign is only used to denote the number of padding bits that are used, and we can infer that during decoding, Base64 URL encoding doesn't actually use any padding. There is no padding in Base64 URL encoding. So for example, the Base64 encoded string plus forward slash uppercase Y equals would just be represented as hyphen underscore uppercase Y in Base64 URL encoding. So that's Base64 encoding. Simple, widely used, and super handy to understand if you're working with HTTP, APIs, or even just poking around in tools like Burp Suite. If you found this helpful, give the video a like and don't forget to subscribe to the channel. Remember, if there's another web tech or security concept you want me to break down, drop it in the comments below. Until next time, happy hacking.